scripture from the Hebrew Bible, Isaiah 60, 1 to 6, 11. It's translated by Reverend Wilda C. Gaffney, PhD. Arise, daughter, shine, daughter, for your light has come, daughter, and the glory of the Holy One has risen upon you, daughter. For watch now, daughter. Leafness shall cover the earth, and thick leafness the fields. And upon you, daughter, the Holy One will rise, and over you, daughter, God's glory will appear. Nations shall come to your light, daughter, and monarchs to the brightness of your dawn, daughter. Lift your eyes round about, daughter, and see. All of them gather, they come to you, daughter. Daughter, your son shall come from far away, and your daughter shall be carried on the nurse's hip. Then, daughter, you shall see and be radiant. Your heart, daughter, shall tremble and swell, because the abundance of the sea shall turn toward you, daughter. The wealth of the nation shall come to you, daughter. A multitude of camels shall cover you, daughter, young camels, a Midian ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall proclaim the praises of the Holy One. Your gates shall always be open, daughter. Day and night they shall not be shut, so that nations shall bring you their wealth, daughter, being led by their monarchs. And a witness of scripture from the Christian Testament, Matthew 2, 1 through 12, is translated by Reverend Wilda C. Gaffney, PhD. Now Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod. Suddenly sages from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the true-born king of the Judeans? We have seen a star at its ascent, and have come to reverence him." When King Herod heard this, he was shaken, and all Jerusalem with him. Then calling together all his chief priests and religious scholars of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah would be born. They said to him, "At Bethlehem of Judea, for it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, by no means are least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the sages and learned from them at the time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go, search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and reverence him." When they had heard the king, they left. And there suddenly was a star that they had seen at its ascent going before them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they rejoiced. Their joy was exuberant. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and reverenced him. Then opening their treasury, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. And the witness of spirit, the author unknown. The best time for a new beginning is now. A word of God that's still speaking. Thanks.
Will you pray with me? Merciful God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our help and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, today is the second Sunday after Christmas, as well as New Year's Day and the Sunday immediately preceding the Feast of Epiphany. A few weeks ago, Nina and I were scratching our heads trying to make sense of which readings we were supposed to share today. And I'll have you know that we weren't the only ones. I've had colleagues across the country say, "Now, which Sunday is it?" The particular alignment of our calendar this year presented us with several different options for our Sunday worship. And so rather than look back to Christmas, which was wonderful, and I thought instead might we look forward. Although I'm sure my Episcopal colleagues would surely scoff and argue that we are only midway through Christmastide, and there are 12 days of Christmas, and like I'm making some kind of war on Christmas, I'll say I'm not Episcopalian, and the UCC affords us a level of liturgical freedom with order that I am most grateful for. So, because I'm sure none of you are coming back on Friday for the Feast of Epiphany, and in fact, I'm just very grateful that you're all here today when you could be elsewhere in bed, for instance, I would say we are celebrating the light, the season of light that is Epiphany. This Friday is officially the Feast of Epiphany, the beginning of the season. And say, I was not raised in a liturgical church, so if that word Epiphany doesn't mean much to you, don't worry, I'm going to explain. Generally speaking, an epiphany is defined as a sudden manifestation or perception of the essential nature or meaning of something. If I was to explain it to my kids, I would say, it's kind of an aha moment. It is a sudden revelation. Within the Christian tradition, Epiphany, or Theophany as it's called in the Eastern Orthodox Church, relates specifically to the manifestation or the appearance of Christ to the Gentiles, those who were not within the Jewish community. And it's recognized in this story, the visitation of the Magi. Now, in some ways, we sort of bump this into Christmas. If you were here on Christmas Eve, you noticed we shared that reading then as well. That's, again, not very Episcopalian of me, but we tend to bring these two stories together when, in fact, they were probably separated by a year or 2 years. But this day, Epiphany, is a long-held tradition. And in some cultures, in some traditions, it's celebrated as Three Kings Day, or King's Day, and might have a Rosca de Reyes cake. It's a little tiny plastic baby Jesus hidden in there, and the lucky person who finds that is lucky for a whole year, I guess. Epiphany with Christmas and Easter is one of the oldest Christmas festivals, and with that has traditions that go back centuries. Now today, as we selected this text, we read it from Dr. Will Gaffney's Women's Lectionary for the World Church. And she selected two readings of the four that she offered. I selected two, Isaiah chapter 60 and Matthew chapter 2. Now one, the later one, probably sounded rather familiar, and the former one probably sounded a little new or different from what you were used to. The passage from Isaiah, well, it comes at a time when the people of God were in exile. They were in exile in Babylon. And the author of Isaiah, and it may have been three different books of Isaiah, but the author imagines a day when the people, and all people, will be drawn to their holy city, drawn to Zion, the holy city of God. And the text describes the city with language of feminine imagery, of daughter. Gaffney personifies the city of Zion as a radiant daughter, saying, "Arise, daughter, for your light has come." And sometimes we speak of the church with feminine language as the bride of Christ. So that's not all that unusual. But this imagery is very, very powerful. And we're going to read a little bit more next week when we delve into chapter 52. What probably caught your attention today was that portion there where it talks about monarchs coming bearing gifts of gold and frankincense. Now, while we're conditioned to read the Christmas story back onto this text, it's important to remember that there was an original audience, an original purpose and message that Isaiah was trying to convey. At the time of the writing, the city of Zion was not radiant. It was anything but. They were still in captivity in Babylon. And the city of Zion had been looted and robbed of its material and human resources over three successive exiles. It's in that context that the prophet presents this vision of a city radiant, restored to its former beauty, renewed to a time of peace and prosperity. I was trying to think of a fitting analogy for today, sort of came back to the news of this last week, particularly out of Ukraine. The news I heard this last week of a terrible shelling of the city of Kyiv, and whereas many people hoped that maybe for Christmas there would be a ceasefire, that never developed. There was continued shelling of the city, throughout Christmas and then even New Year's, leaving the people without power, without water, without heat. There's an image of a Christmas tree in the center of the city that used to be illuminated, but now is covered with paper peace screens. And still it shines forth, but not the way it used to. I thought about how this vision might be portrayed today, how the current or present citizens of that city might imagine a day when their city would be restored to its former glory, when its cultural wealth and riches, its people would be returned, its buildings rebuilt, and once again, people from all over the world would come and be drawn to that place instead of having to flee. This was a vision of hope that Isaiah was presenting to the people. It was not a vision of reality. It was a vision of what might be, a prayer, a dream, a hope of a brighter future. Now, generations later, after the Babylonian captivity, the author of the Gospel of Luke described how Magi, or how Gaffney translates as sages, noting that there is neither number nor gender specified in the Greek, but how these sages follow the star from the east, bringing with them gifts of gold and frankincense. But wait, there's myrrh. Though some have speculated that they were Persian or Babylonian or Zoroastrian astrologers, somehow they've heard about this text, this prophet Micah. And they've read the text, and they've come to seek others who know it better, who can tell them where to find this one born the king of Judah. They were observers of stars and celestial bodies, and they followed that star to Bethlehem in search of a child of promise. They come foretelling a ruler who will rise up from the line of Judah to be a shepherd of the people of Israel. And this is perhaps, again, a year or 2 years after the birth. But then they find the Christ child with his mother Mary, and they are overjoyed, and they fall down to reverence him. If you read the text, you see that it does not say three kings. It does not say that they were all men. But over the years, these ideas have sort of developed. We've come to know them as three kings, three wise men, as Caspar, Melchior, and Balthazar, but that's all non-canonical. That's not in the text itself. All we have from the text is the three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And preachers have made a lot about what those mean, about the kingly influence of the gold and the priestly infants, you know, reference of the frankincense and the foreboding of the myrrh that can be used to embalm Jesus for his burial. But they come, they find the child, and they pay him homage. That word that will forever give kids in pageants fits. Homage. They reverence him. They worship him. And of course, there's that wrench in the story, right? King Herod. King Herod, a puppet king of the Roman Empire, who has authority over this whole province of Judea. Herod was known for great building projects and for his tyrannical rule. And to him, this news is most unwelcome. The story goes that he is so threatened by the news of this child-born king of the Judeans, this is Gaffney's very helpful translation, he's so troubled that he calls for an infanticide, for what preachers often call the massacre of the innocents. Most scholars don't actually believe that that took place, thankfully. And yet, its mention has echoes of another story, of Pharaoh, and how he directed the midwives to throw baby boys into the Nile. If we read into the following verses, we learn that this threat of violence, just the threat of violence, forces the Holy Family to flee, to seek refuge in Egypt. The sages are warned in a dream not to return to Herod as he directs, but to go home by another way. And while the story paints a somewhat bleak picture of the world into which Jesus of Nazareth was born, there is a light that shines in the night. Indeed, without the darkness of the night, they would never have found the child in the first place. They would have never been able to follow the star. Now, Daphne talks a lot about the language we use throughout Advent and into this season of Epiphany, both seasons of light. She chooses very intentionally the word bleakness. Did you notice that? Bleakness. She chooses this to counter the way our racialized society has historically associated darkness with negative, often denigrating dark or darker-skinned people. And so it's worth emphasizing that the darkness of night can be a gift. It can be a place of peace and rest. It can invite wonder and beauty. It can even shelter those who are fleeing for refuge. In the same way, when speaking of Herod's subjects, Daphne chose the word Judeans. You might have caught that as well. Other translations choose words like the Jews or Jews. Not only are those words very complicated in today's modern political world, where there is a nation state called Israel, but it has a very different meaning in light of the anti-Semitism that we see in our world today. Using that term, Judeans, is not just correct geographically, but it offers a welcome specificity, clarity. It does not carry the cultural baggage that other terms do. The words we use matter. How we use them matters. And when we know better, we can do better. Which is why we continue to study and learn and read these stories again and again, praying that they will help us grow. And that together, we will be better. Still today, powerful and insecure leaders wreak havoc and devastation on the vulnerable. Still today, families flee violence and the threat of violence. People seek safety and shelter within and across borders. And in place of Mary and Joseph and Jesus, we can just as easily speak of Maria and Joseph and Jesus, or Nika and Vladislav and Ghassan, names that are Hispanic or Iranian and Ukrainian or Palestinian. These stories are still alive today in our experience. We see them all around us. As we turn the calendar page from one year to the next, we know well that our world still needs more light. We need more light. We pray for more love and light to shine forth in and through us every day. And I have to say, my title for this sermon, Let Love Light Our Way, is inspired by one of your Christmas cards, which inspired me. It was a blessing. Let love light our way. What a beautiful prayer for us in this year, as we begin this new year. And I wonder, what would it look like for us to let love light our way? What would it look like for us to love ourselves and one another, our neighbors? I come back to just a story earlier this week. I had a chance to call back to an old friend, and we were reminiscing about our ministry a long time ago, more than 20 years ago. And how we had changed, and how our thoughts had changed, and the things we had preached then we would never preach now. And we were both praying, I hope people will forgive us for all of the things we've missaid and misspoken, the ways that our words might have caused unintentional harm. I said, I hope we can forgive our younger selves. We need to do that. As much as we need to forgive one another, we bump into each other and hurt each other purposely or unintentionally. We need to learn how to let love light our way. wondering, what if we were to view other people not by the labels of homeless or refugee or asylum seeker, but just as seekers and sojourners like us, drawn by the holy light? Seekers bearing their own gifts to be shared, like us. What might such a view teach us about ourselves and each other? What might we learn as we share our gifts and receive one another's gifts? A scholar and theologian, Liddy Barlow, was writing about this story through the interfaith lens. She says, what a beautiful story to talk about interfaith dialogue. Imagine these Persian or Babylonian or Zoroastrian astrologers and how they are drawn to the Christ child. And you notice there's no like doctrinal statements involved in this story. No one checked if they were baptized. No one told them they had to accept their Lord and Savior by saying this prayer with them. They were just drawn. That scares me a little bit. That's a different way of imagining how the light draws us. Liddy Barlow talks about six stars, that these Magi invite us to contemplate. The first star is that we are invited to cross boundaries. The Magi did not wait for the newborn king to find them. Instead, they actively searched for an opportunity to greet him. They disrupted their lives. They packed their bags and set out on a long journey, compelled by this opportunity to meet the king, the one born king of Judah. It's hard for me to say it about. Interfaith encounters require us to take initiative. We can be the ones to make the first call or write the first email introduction. We can be the ones to travel from our home turf to another's rather than expecting others to come to us. These are good things. Barlow also says we should be curious. The Magi knew of a prophecy relating to the birth of the king in the land of Judah, but they were not familiar with the Hebrew scriptures describing where the Messiah was to be born. Instead, trying to decode the text alone, they went to those most knowledgeable about the faith and asked for help. Our experience is deepened when we ask good questions to those who know their traditions best, rather than making assumptions and trying to figure everything out on our own. We can learn to be learners, to ask questions. Star number three was to recognize the holy in the other. When the Magi found the child, they rejoiced exceedingly. Or as R.T. France puts it, they were thrilled to bits, and they knelt before him. We may not always be able to participate fully in our neighbor's worship, but we can still experience the numinous ways, the luminous light of God in these encounters. We can recognize the ways God is at work in their life, our life, all of our lives together. We can honor the sacred experience that we all share. Star four, we can bring our best to the encounter. The Magi brought precious gifts to the child, items both symbolic and of practical significance. We can leave our myrrh at home, she says, but we can still offer our best selves to our neighbors, entering into new conversations with generosity of spirit, with kindness, with open minds. Star number five, we can take risks for others' well-being. It would have been easy for the Magi to return to Jerusalem as instructed, telling Herod exactly where to find the child. Instead, they chose to depart in secret, guarding Jesus' location and seeking to keep him safe. In a nation where Christians are the majority, we must pay attention to our neighbor's safety as they practice their faiths. We must be willing to sacrifice to ensure their free exercise of their religion. And finally, the last star she offers is this, to expect to be changed. The Magi did not return by the same road. They found a new way home. Our conversations, all of our conversations,
especially our conversations across faith or tradition, can be transformative. They can change our perspectives. It can help us sharpen our empathy and enrich our understanding. And we will not go back the same way that we came. 2,000 years later, we can give thanks for these gifts, the gifts of the Magi, and their example for us in bridging the differences that are between us. And so as we enter this season of Epiphany, this new year together, my prayer is this, that we would let love light our way this day.